Since Norman times, the English have maintained a presence in Ireland, but by the 17th century, after Cromwell's invasion and the Williamite War, most independent regions had been subdued. Then, under British control, Protestants in the Anglican Church of Ireland took over all aspects of society and most of the land, and this was known as the Protestant Ascendancy. And they introduced penal laws disenfranchising Catholics and non-Anglicans. Then, in the late 18th century, the Enlightenment brought revolutions on both sides of the Atlantic, and during the American Revolution, the British raised the Irish Volunteers to defend the region from a potential French invasion. However, this army allowed Presbyterians and some Catholics into their ranks, and they demanded reforms, which were met, like the creation of the Constitution of 1782, granting the Irish Parliament more powers. Meanwhile, around the same time, the Whig Party was founded in Ireland, and attracted support from reformers and radicals. Then Henry Grattan took over the Irish Patriot Party, and the British were willing to make even more concessions to them after the French Revolution. For instance, in 1793, some property-owning Catholics could vote, and Protestant liberals, particularly in Belfast, spread even more radical ideas through the Belfast newsletter. For instance, in 1791, Wolfetone, a Protestant, published the Arguments on Behalf of the Catholics of Ireland. And with the likes of Napatandy and Thomas Russell, the Society of United Irishmen was founded. But divisions in Ireland over religion remained, as groups like the Protestant People Day Boys fought the Catholic defenders. But as Britain went to war with France, the societies began to be seen as traitorous due to their affiliations with the French Republic. So they began to be persecuted and disbanded in 1795. They reformed the next year, and with many leaders now in exile, they hoped France would lead an invasion force of Ireland. France sent 14,000 men in 1786 under Hoche to Ireland. However, poor weather forced them back, and another expedition from the Batavian Republic, the French puppet state in the Low Countries, was crushed by the British fleet. But the United Irishmen grew to around 300,000 people. However, Catholics soon turned against them because their French allies invaded the Papal States in 1798, and the British had imposed martial law and began to crack down on the society. Nevertheless, the militant faction within the United Irishmen pushed for a rebellion without French aid, even though the Royal Navy could easily blockade the island. And informants within the group alerted the British to the planned date of the uprising in May 1798, and loyalists in the newly founded Orange Order provided recruits and further intelligence. So the British stationed troops in planned assembly points in Dublin and arrested most of the leaders, preventing a major uprising in Dublin. And they were crushed in other places like County Meath, Antrim and Down. And in Wicklow, the loyalists massacred suspected rebels, but the surviving rebels did launch a successful guerrilla campaign. And similar guerrilla campaigns were launched in Kildare and Wexford, but only 10% of the society joined the armed conflict and 20,000 British troops were sent into Wexford. And there, at Vinegar Hill, they crushed the rebels in late June, forcing them to flee north into Ulster. So the main rebellion had been crushed in about a month, but 2 months later General Humbert landed with 1,000 French troops in County Mayo. He united with 5,000 rebels, defeated the British at Castlebar, and declared the formation of the Irish Republic. Although this inspired some to rise up in support, it only lasted over 10 days, as the British, with 10 times more troops, crushed the Irish again. But Wolfetone, who had been in France throughout, finally set sail to Ireland in October, with about 3,000 French troops, hoping to land in Donegal. The Royal Navy, however, intercepted them, and this final invasion attempt never landed, and the rebellion was largely over, with many rebels being executed by the British under Cornwallis. But some guerrillas continued to fight, like in the Wicklow Mountains under Michael Dwyer, and they only lay down their arms after the failed Emmet's Rebellion in 1803. And to further quell the misrule of the Protestant ascendancy and end further rebellions, the Acts of Union were passed in 1801, uniting Britain and Ireland, largely thanks to Cornwallis buying parliamentary votes in Ireland. This video is part of a series covering Irish rebellions in the 19th century, including the Young Irelander Rebellion of 1848 and the Fenian Raids into Canada, and you can find the rest of them on thearmchairhistorian.com. There you can also find a wide range of exclusive videos made by some of your favourite YouTube historians like Potential History, History with Hilbert, Mr. Beat, The Cynical Historian, Canubus, and many, many more. There they post videos free from restrictions set by advertisers and censors, and you will not only be getting a whole host of new videos, but will play a major role in supporting the creation of new videos each and every month. And if you sign up today, you can get a free month trial, and if you use the promo code JABZY100, you can get an additional 1 month free. So sign up and take a look through the extensive catalogue of never-before-seen history videos.